So, hello everybody again. We are here for the second seminar today. This will be based on a technique called non-parametric combination, that is essentially a non-parametric way of doing meta-analysis.
And in that sense, it will be heavily based on what we have seen yesterday. So, the first thing that I would like to know is whether there are any questions about all the meta-analysis things that we have seen yesterday. There is anything that is not clear yet? Or is there a few ones?
Yeah, could you comment a bit on your opinion, which is, depending on the type of data you have, it's better to use the ranking system or the other systems that you can use? Because you send the result that the ranking is really dangerous. Mm-hmm. You don't have correlation with the sample. So.
Okay, the question is very general. But I can provide you some questions. Essentially, you must use them, depending by how much information you have, then you decide which method to use. So, if you only have enough information to use rank methods, you go for the rank method. If you have rich information, that like variables and values and so on, and effect sizes, then it makes sense to use some more complicated method, and so on. So, whatever you can use, you go for that. So, this is what I will suggest. Any other question about this? About meta-analysis there? Okay, so let's start talking about non-parametric combination and what is this and why do we use it. First of all, I want to give some motivations before talking about what is the non-parametric combination. The motivation is the following. In pretty much all the meta-analysis methods we have seen, we assume that we have independent samples. Meaning that every single study is performed on its own cohort. You don't have common samples on them. Why is this important? This is important for a simple fact that whenever you have common samples, most probably you are going to have correlated results, strong correlated results, and more than correlated, more strongly dependent results, associated results. And this is not good for a simple fact that in this way you create some type of dependency that is artificial. Actually, we have seen with the ranking method that if you have three, four, five columns of pretty much identical results, then you are going to have some significant findings, even if it's not the case. So the key point is that when you do meta-analysis, you do want to have independent samples. Now, I want to ask a question. If you go, for example, on the Espresso Omnibus and you try to retrieve some data sets out of the same disease, how probable is it, in your opinion, that they are going to have some sample in common? So essentially, you go online on the Espresso Omnibus, you type COPD, and you retrieve some data sets. How possible is that they have some samples in common?
It could be possible because normally the controls could be came from biobanks or something like that, and the same controls for the different experiments.
So probability zero, possibility. Or in general. Somebody else here? Okay, in my former lab, in a lab where I was associated until where I was belonging until a few months ago, in Crete. My former supervisor makes pretty much a lot of studies about that integration. And one of my colleagues, one of my fellow postdocs back then, she was actually studying pretty much a lot the interconnections between the samples and studies in ZO. And she came out with a very nice paper for the biodata, and a very nice paper also in a website, where she essentially has curated in a semi-automatic way many of the series in ZO that are not yet curated. It's actually a first step for a larger project that they are performing in Crete, but this was already a pretty much not outcome. So it get published in this year. So what you see here are some Eridotis study in ZO from this specific platform. This is very common. Of course, these are not all of the studies. These are only the studies that have samples in common with some companies. We are not the study. So you can see the approach study here, but you can go on this website under networks, if you like. So essentially, this study here, for example, has a connection with this one has a connection with this one, and so on. And all these connections are actually samples that are in common. And when I was saying COPD, I did it on purpose because actually this cluster here are all samples with both COPD. So these are all studies, in the supposed independent studies, but nevertheless, they were sharing some samples. So this is just one thing in order to understand that this assumption here of independency is pretty much MV easily violated in this case. So this is essentially one motivation why actually some of the assumption meta-analysis are violated. Then there is also one other motivation to actually why we start studying this non-parametric combination in the first place. So everybody knows what is this? Everybody have ever seen this website? Not at all? Okay, if you have never seen this website, I would really suggest you to have a look. First to the browser and then to a website. It's actually an incredibly large initiative with a number of outcome publications that is quite almost countless. Well, essentially, this is, I think, the largest, one of the largest collection of data, molecular data about cancer, with thousands of samples, several different data types, it's curated by the NIH. And so essentially what happened that for several different types of cancer, for several different types of cancer, you have usually hundreds of samples, and for each single sample, then you have several omics measured on each sample. The omics spanning expression, copy number variation, methylation, plus some clinical information. Not all the clinical information is open for privacy issues, for the privacy. However, all the molecular data are there, and also some information about the outcome. They have also healthy controls, so this is an extremely large, interesting collection of data. This is actually an extremely large multi-omics collection of data. So from here you can seriously acquire as many omics data you want in order to test whatever we are discussing here, like non-parametric combination, VCA, and so on. And so the point here is the following. For example, we have a copy number variation and expression. From this website, you can essentially download all of them. So you can select 100 patients, or 100 patients, 100 controls. And for each one of them, you can have both expression data, you can have copy variation data, copy number variation data. And then you can start working on them. And then you can start to observe, for example, which gene is defense expressed in terms of expression or in terms of copy number. And then, if you wanted to somehow merge this information, merge these key values about the expression copy number variation, you can do that with whatever method you used yesterday, but it will be probably inaccurate. Because again, these are the same samples, meaning that you expected these datasets to be correlated, to be associated. And again, in this case, you violate the assumptions of the methods, you need other techniques. One of these is the non-parametric combination. So this is the motivation, essentially. The point is that either you do a study or multiple datasets, or either you do a multi-omic study, you need to understand that in this case, the usual meta-analysis methods are prone to failure because the data sets are correlated. It's actually a figure for a paper that we published in 2016. Essentially, these lines here are the methods I'm going to present now. This is omics MPC. And this is for increasing correlation among the data sets. So you see, some of and then this AUC essentially is a measure of how good were the methods in order to retrieve some different expertise. Essentially, straight is good, going down is bad. And what you see is that whatever was using a non-parametric combination, meaning whatever was not assuming that the data were uncorrelated was going well. This one, CP, was actually the Fisher method that was going straight down. And this was actually the rank method that were going even more down. Meaning that whatever, actually this is pretty much obvious in a sense, because here we introduced correlations. Both the Fisher method and the rank method, they assume there is no correlation, so of course they degrade. While instead, other methods that they don't assume that they were able to, have the same performance essentially. So, when we talk about this non-parametric combination, what is this essentially? You have just to think about this like a non-parametric Fisher, Stauffer, or Lipper method. Nothing more, nothing less. So you have some p-values, and you want to essentially to merge these p-values. You know the p-values are correlated, so you cannot actually merge just with a normal method. That's all. So let's see essentially a very simplified representation of a much more complicated problem. I want to just represent what is the settings where you should use the NGS. These are actually settings that are very common in any multi-problem study, any study with these multi-problems. So essentially what you have in a study with multiple-omics, it is the following. You have your samples, for example, 100 patients, 100 controls. You measure the first type of molecular data. There can be gene expression or something else. You measure the second type of molecular data, for example, methylation. And then what you have that only part of the samples were measured in both cases. And this can be for several reasons. Several reasons, because, for example, you run out of money before you could do all the economical constraints. Some of the patients were not available when you made the second measurements. Or when you have, in case of biobanks, maybe you just finished your aliquot of biospecimen. So it can happen. Often it is the case that you are going to have some holes here, meaning that you are not going to have a complete design. And then you have some phenotype information about your samples. So this is pretty much common sense. These are all your measurements. And on top of this problem, on top of this setting, what then happens, and again, this is not just for NGS, but for any type of multiple omics study, then what happens is that you sell somehow associated measurements in one data set. We measure the second data set. How different is this? If this is, for example, gene expression, this one that are microRNA, how will you do that? Okay, let me address the question. Which database of microRNA gene expression gene interaction will be using this case? Have you ever done any of this study, for example? So the point is the following. If on the same patient you measure gene expression data and microRNA, then you want to know for each microRNA which are its own the targets. And one way to do that, actually to use some database, online database like Mirwork, that it will give you a list of targeted genes for each microRNA. And then what you want to do is not to just to have each single microRNA into computer correlation with each single gene, but you want to take the microRNA and to compute the correlation with its own targets, at least most of the times. Of course, things are not so easy, because then you start saying, okay, which are the targets? If I take only the targets that are experimentally validated, these are very sure. However, then these are extremely biased because most of the validation for microRNA, for the targets of microRNA, are in the context of cancer studies. So if you are studying something, you are probably not going to retrieve information you need. But then you have, for example, other types of you have also predictions, I mean predicted targets, meaning that on the basis of the sequence of the microRNA, you can predict which is the genes that were essentially biased, but then the predictions are very noisy and so on. What I want to say is that this program here, so this slide here, it's where you are going to spend most of the time. I mean, if you are going to make a multi-omics studies at any point, where you are going to spend a lot of time actually just in this small part. One more example, for example, when David was talking about methylation data in the espresso. In how many ways you can link methylation in espresso? Every CPG island with every gene where the CPG island is located. Do you want to compute a single methylation level for the promoter of the gene? How do you want to do that? You have several ways to do this. None of them is absolute correct one, and you have to decide. So this, that's to say that in general, this is where you are going to spend most of the time. It's very problem specific, and it is not something easy at all. Not to mention that most of the time what you are going to have is an end-to-end relationship. Meaning that one single element here can mask several elements here and so on. So, we are in this context. And for example, once you have all these arcs here, you can do different things. One thing, for example, you can take the common samples and test them for correlations. This is what we were seeing also with this, for example. What you are going to do here is different. Essentially, you want to take whatever is the p-value computed on this measurement with regards to the association with this phenotype. Then we want to take the p-values associated with one of these measurements, again, with respect to the association with this phenotype. We want to merge these p-values. We cannot do this with standard meta-analysis because essentially the pattern that have common samples, most probably we are going to have also dependencies there. So how are we going to do that? So now there are more or less 20 more slides. This is the last slide without any mathematical notation. So be ready. I'm telling you. So, let's start. Essentially what you do, here I just got these two measurements, measurement 1 and measurement 2. It's that we know that there are common samples, we know that there are links somehow, either this is a microRNA, this is the target genes, or methylation and the expression and so on. So, now what you want to do is the following. I take the first measurement, I compute the association here on its own samples with the phenotype, and I compute the statistics. This, for example, is the statistics. Can be also another type of statistic, correlation, for example, a correlation. Then I take the second measurement, I compute the association heterotype, and I get also again the association. For each single notation that we have in the slides, I will have a small part here where I describe every time what I report. So this is the beginning of the analysis, and if we didn't have the problem of associated measurements, from the statistic, you could just compute the p-value, merge it with the Fisher, and it's it. And we are done, just two goals more. Since we cannot do that, what we do will be some permutation analysis. Who knows what is permutation? Go ahead, please.
Yes, I mean, simulating measurements one again and then compute a huge statistic for all the measurements.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, good try. Yeah,
it's a very distinct combination, isn't it?
No, it's okay. It's acceptable definition. So, let's see what happens here. This is my phenotype information. Let's say PSS controls. I computed here an association between this measurement and this other one. Now, what I do, I just take these numbers here. This is that you have to imagine that we have 0 and 1. And then I just scramble them. I just randomly assign each single patient to one of the two classes. Now, this one was the statistic, for example, the correlation, computed when we have the original phenotype. This is the correlation computed when we have the permute phenotype. What do you expect? If it is the correlation of 0.8, do you expect this one to be a correlation of 0.9? What do you think? Can this be the case? Or better, how probable is that this will be a higher correlation?
Low.
So you expect a lower correlation?
Yes, in general.
This is because if whatever I'm studying has sense, I expect that the association between my measurement and my phenotype is not random. If I'm doing a correct experiment, whatever I'm measuring should be associated somehow with my phenotype. So I do expect here a quite high association between my measurement and my phenotype. When I permute randomly here, I essentially destroy any type of association between the phenotype and the molecular measurement. And so I do expect these values to be less significant. That means they are lower. So if these are high correlations, this will be lower correlations. Or at least this is what I hope. However, it's not always the case, because it's a matter if I do these permutations thousands of times, I may, by chance, find a combination here that actually gives me higher correlations. And this happens especially if I have low sample size. Are these things new for most of you? Have you ever seen these permutation-based methods? Permutation-based methods are pretty much nice because they are not parametric, meaning that you may divide them and use them often. So, and with often, I mean also in cases where you don't have close form. In order to use them. So if I do this n times, where n usually lasts like 10,000 times, then I have a matrix here, where I have my original statistics. And then I have essentially all these other statistics here. So hopefully you expect that your statistic here, for example your correlation, your original one, very high, and all of these ones are very low, is what you call. But it's not always like that. One important thing for the non-parametric combination is that I permute only the phenotype, but I don't permute the measurements. Why? If I don't permute the measurements, what happens? Or if I permute the measurements instead of the phenotype, what will happen? It's actually a very tricky question, sorry, because I give it by granted, but actually it's not so so immediate. So essentially, if I permute my measurements, I will destroy the data distribution cluster. This is why it's better to permute exclusively what you want to test against, that is the neural net. It's a technicality, but it is important if you are going to ever done permutation analysis, even outside of the non-parametric combination. Whatever type of permutation analysis you want to do, you always want to just permute the only as few information as possible, so that you only destroy the association in the study and not the other ones. So now, let's say I have this correlation here, 0.9. Let's say I have all these other correlations. What happens if I take the proportion of statistics here that are more extreme than the one that I observed? So here, for example, I have 10,000 correlations. I just count how many of them are larger than my original one, and I take the proportions. What is this? This is the proportion of statistics that are larger or equal than the observed one. Does it ring a bell to you?
Something like a divide?
Right. So essentially, you can use permutations in order to compute p-values. How do you usually compute p-values? Okay, don't tell me I just read the line of polynomial. Okay. I know you do that, but what is behind that? When you compute a p-value, you essentially compute a statistic. That is, for example, the t-statistic for a correlation. And then you compare this against a theoretical distribution. You can do that because there was some extremely smart guy, much smarter than me, that actually came out saying, you know what, if you compute a statistic with this assumption, you know that that statistic might follow more or less this theoretical distribution. And so once you know that, once you know, have the information this theoretical distribution behind it, you can compute the p-value. But if you don't have this theoretical distribution, what do you do? So one possibility are permutation constraints. So you permute here this thing, the phenotype. You have essentially your vector of permuted statistics. And then you compare these ones, the original one, against the other ones. If about half of the permuted statistics are larger than what you got at the beginning, your p-value will be around 0.5. And this is the meaning essentially you expect that by chance you have a strong correlation to what you observe. So this is exactly what this formula says. So it looks very bad and ugly, but actually it's just a proportion. Actually, I could have even complicated this more and put in an absolute value, but for sake of comprehension, I do that. And all that I do is just to take the proportion between the Parisian statistic and the other ones. That's it. And I compute the p-value. Now, this is where this is just classical statistics. This is nothing more than classical statistics. That's it. This is permutation-based statistics. From now on, it started a non-parametric combination. And there will be a few steps that probably you will not immediately understand, but they will lead us to a conclusion. So let's start from a step that is not very clear at the beginning, but essentially what I do now is to take the first statistic that was computed under permutation, and I compare this against the other ones. Again, I will take a p-value, but it's an atypical p-value, because essentially I get a p-value of something that I know should not be significant. And I can do this for all the measurements. And so essentially, from a matrix of statistics, I go to a matrix of values. How bad is this? It's okay. And it's always the same format. It's just nothing in the proportion. But then, if I have all these nasty values here, I can combine them. I can combine every single row. Correct? So, essentially, I can combine, for example, with the fish. I take the first value on the first duct, the p value on the second duct. I combine them with this form, and I get some statistics, capital P statistic. This one just tells me, essentially, what is the combined, this is a measure of the significance, of the combined significance of the two measures. So this just tells me, if I consider the two measures together, how big it is the significance. How significant they are together. And then I can do this for each single line. And so again, I get here a sense of how much the two measurements are significant when considered together on my original data. And in this vector here, instead I know how much the two statistics, the two measurements are significant together, where they should not be significant. So, what can I do on this vector? In the sense that we use only one formula in this lesson. So. So, what I can do on this vector here? This is made on the half. This is the number that tells me how significant are these two together. These are the numbers that tell me how to significant these two together with the permutations. So what can I do here? No, you don't answer because you know the answer. Somebody else? Yeah. So essentially, I take again the proportion of how many of the statistics here are larger than the one that I mentioned. And this final p-value is essentially the p-value tells me how much these two measurements are significant when taken together. And it's nothing else than what we have seen with the fish combination method in the previous lesson. Just that this time, we derive it in a non-parametric way. And why this? Because the assumption of the fish method that the assumption independent is not respected. So I can use that formula and then to use some non-parametric way. This is some pretty much convoluted statistics. So is there any questions here? You understand the motivations why we use something like that and so on? Okay. So what is a good thing is that there is a non-parametric approach. And one very good thing about this method is that you can use different type combinations. So you can use Fisher, you can use Stauffer, if you see, we've seen the other time, we can use Dippet, Malanowicz distance, you can use actually every possible type of combination there. Because at the end of the day, you don't need to know what is the theoretical distribution behind your computer. What is a drawback of this method that it really requires a lot of computations. And this is common in all possible permutation methods. This is always the case for permutation methods. So, NPC is one possibility. It's one possible alternative to meta-analysis when you have some dependency across the samples, as it is the case in multi-omic studies. But there are also other type of alternatives. I mean, there are other type of methods. So we here are going to get down and more down in the rabbit hole of the of statistics. So essentially what happens is the following that as usually, you find the answer to your problem in some totally unrelated papers. So when we were studying this problem here, we actually found an alternative NPC to a totally different paper it was not talking about omics data at all. It was just a theoretical effect about the theory of statistics. So essentially, the problem is this is the case. When you are studying multiple omics at the end of the day, you have, it's essentially you have different statistical tests. Each one of these giving you a p-value, like what we have seen before here. Since you have a maximum measurement, all these are associated because this is the microRNA, this is the target gene, or this is the gene, and this is the methylation site. And for each one of these things here, you get a p-value, and you may want to measure it, or to study it together. And this is exactly what we have here, that for each, you have several hypotheses, and for each one you have a p-value. And then essentially, one way to study this is to answer this question. Can I get a sense of how true is this statement, that at least a number out of these n p-values are essentially significant? In order to answer this, actually there was this paper in 2008 from Benzamini. This is the same guy that actually created the fast discovery rate. One of these papers was cited 40,000 times, 50,000 times in this. Since every time you do p dot adjust in R, you're actually using his work. So, respectively. So, essentially, he came out with a nice paper in 2008, where essentially says if I want to compute, if I want to have a p value that tells me what is. That essentially assesses the statistical significance of U out of N p-values, and we just combine them like this. So, in a sense, try to imagine you have four studies. For each study, you have one p-value. And so you say, okay, I want another p-value that tells me how likely it is that two of these p-values are significant. Any two of them out of this four, or three of them out of this four, or the four of them, and so on. Essentially, the guy came out with this, Professor Benjamin, came out with this extremely interesting formula, the STATegra. And what actually is interesting for us is that this approach is able to deal with the association between the p-values. So even if the p-values are dependent, even if the p-values are dependent because, for example, you have measured them on common samples, you can still use this formula. It's not totally clear up to which point this formula is robust. There are some cases where you cannot use it. It's pretty much difficult to find them out. But most of the time, you can use it also when the p-values are correlated. And what is even more interesting is that when you U is equal to 1, so essentially when you are asking, is there the case that at least one of these two values is statistically significant? Then the formula reduced to this one, there is exactly the FTR formula. And so all that you have to put there in R is this one. Does it work? Yeah, in general it works because we tried in our paper, yeah, it was working pretty much well. It was the best method among the parametric ones. So essentially what happens is that when you have samples, common samples of your measurement, and your results are likely to be correlated, if you use a non-parametric method, you are pretty much safe. If you want to use a parametric method, it's better to use this formula from Benzamini because it actually gives you a very good level of robustness. And one more reason to use also Benzamini is because it's pretty much fast. So essentially what you have here is that if you have any type of multi-omics analysis and you want to combine the values there, you know you have some overlap between the samples, you must be careful because there can be some dependency across the datasets. if you want to be absolutely sure that you avoid them, you use some non-parametric combination. In this case, it will actually ensure you that you don't have any problem with that. This is a theoretically correct analysis. After the course of some computational time, meaning you have to leave one computer running for one day, this year. Or you can use a parametric method, like Benjamin, or something else if you find it. That essentially assures you that the association between the samples are taken into account. How's it going? Questions? Okay, if there is no question, so I think it's perfectly clear. We will proceed with the hands-on.